Welcome back. It's still TV3 New Day, and now we're taking the discussion to civil servants. And in the studios, I have with me the head of civil service, Nana Kwesi Ejekum Dramina. Thank you so much for joining me, sir.
Pleasure.
And I hope you're well.
I'm well. And you?
I'm fine, thank you. So Great. We've been hearing civil servants. Honestly, I can say that there are a number of people who don't even know who a civil servant is. So let's start that discussion from there before we even go into the celebration.
Great.
So who then is a civil servant?
If you look at the Constitution of Ghana, Article 190 clearly defines, let me start with the public service.
Okay.
That is even a better way to look at it. Article 190 defines the public service. And if you look at that from one, it lists what constitutes a public service. And you are the civil service, the first listed, but there you have health service, recently local government service, immigration service. So all these organizations constitute the public service. So
okay.
The civil service is one of the organizations that is in the considered public service. But specifically, who is a civil servant? The governing law for the civil service is PNDC Law 327, which is a Civil Service Act. And it defines the civil service as any office, usually at the center of government, at the regional level, national level, and at a district level. Basically, that seems to be in a broad stroke.
Okay. Would
it. But then it's divided into, you have different categories. Different categories in the sense that it is not everybody who works at the national or regional or central level who is not a civil a civil servant.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, so the people in the ministries basically are civil servants.
Okay.
So the people in the departments, head offices of the department. Now, that's important. So when you go to Department of Federal Roads, head office is civil service.
The head office.
The head office is civil service. But the regional office and district office is not civil service.
Why is that so?
That's what the law says.
Okay.
It's the creation of the law.
I see.
They belong to the local government service.
All right.
It's the same. So you go to... So a lot of people, because they don't understand these things, Ghana Education Service is not civil service.
No?
The Ministry of Education
is
civil service. But Ghana Education Service is one of the organizations listed... the Constitution. So it's a separate entity. So it's not civil service.
Okay.
Ghana Health Service is not civil service.
Ghana Police Service?
It's not civil service. Immigration is not civil service.
Okay.
The reason why it's confusing is that the civil service has, if you look at the politics of it, has ministerial responsibility over these services.
Okay.
And the chief directors are the chief bureaucrats or advisors to the minister. So in terms of sectors, then they are responsible for the overall, we call a strategic management. But the operational things, so basically civil service focuses on policy formulation, monitoring, evaluation, strategy, guidelines, standard setting.
Okay.
While the other organizations that we call services are responsible for implementation. So for instance, you go to Interior, the Ministry of Interior will be responsible for the formulation of policies for the internal security. But the police service, the immigration service, the NACOP, all those organs will be implementing those policies.
I see. So,
but they are, by law, not civil servants. So it's the creation of the law.
Okay.
The law does not define them as civil servants, but they are part of the public services.
Okay.
So, for instance, if you go to AMA now, and you want a service, AMA is not civil service. KMA is not civil service.
All right.
It's part of the local government service. So there's a head of local government service, engineer Nana Atuata. I call him my reverse height mate. So he's the boss for that organization. Okay. So if there is a problem happening at KMA, the best that I can do is to call Nana Atuata and say, I think I've heard this or I've heard that, or talk to IGP or somebody and say, I've heard that.
But you can't step in.
I don't have a control over that. Even I can't talk to them directly. Strictly speaking, I have to talk to the ministry. Because by the rules, and this is a creation of, whether we agree or not is a different matter.
Well, I believe that there are people who still don't agree with
whether that's the best approach is a different matter. But I'm saying by the creation by law. That is how it's
supposed to. So your reporting lines go to who? The president or
no,
the
ministries? Minister? Each ministry has a minister.
Yeah.
So there's a chief director, then there's a minister who also reports to the president.
So that's the reporting line. I see. Okay, this is the first time I'm hearing this, and I'm sure for you as well, so maybe you're getting educated on this. But now let's move to, we've talked about the mandate, you know, of the civil service as well. Let's talk about some services. So if your job is to do more of, policy
strategy.
How successful has that been for the civil service?
Let me put it this way. You cannot measure the success of the civil service from what happens in the country in general.
Okay.
I usually joke that every government comes to power and they say they've been successful. Now, the civil service is the machinery for the promulgation or development of these policies.
Okay.
Whatever policy you take, planting for food, whatever policy government, is the civil service organization that will do the cabinet memo. Even the transmitter letter. It's usually signed by the chief director, not the minister, to the cabinet. So in that sense, the civil service has participated actively, and it still participates actively. I won't say everything is right. No. That would be quite hypocritical. But I say all of us, since independence, the civil service has played a major role in the development. One of the things that we don't really realize is when we are political transitions, after election, or even during that period when we have military coups, it's the civil service that already held this country.
Okay.
Because before a minister is appointed, there's a chief director, and when a minister comes in, these are the same people who brief them, who hold them, and everything.
Yeah.
Even the development of the notes, the transitional notes, and all that is first and foremost done by the civil service.
So literally,
we put all that together.
They are very instrumental in running the country.
Very critical.
I see.
Very critical.
But also, the civil service has been bedeviled with a lot of challenges. We've heard a number of them. And first of all, attitudinal issues, and then bureaucracy. Are these really things that actually happen? Because when I talk about attitudinal challenges, we've heard stories about how people think that the civil servants don't work the full, you know, 9 to 5, I mean. And so they go to work maybe at 10 a.m. and by 3 o'clock, they're done, they're going home. So they have enough time to work on other things. There's really not much happening. If your supervisor is not at work, it's a free day for you. And so your supervisor comes, you cannot make any decisions, you cannot move. Is that really true?
Again, like every organization, it has its own challenges. So definitely, it will be naive on my part to sit here and say everything, it's correct. But I think what you said is more of an over-exaggeration.
Is it?
Yeah, I think it's very much an over-exaggeration. There are challenges with the civil service, no doubt about that. Attitude, I agree with you. It's one of the key things that my predecessor and I, and we are still working on it.
Okay.
But you see, attitude is not really even the issue of only the civil service. It's Ghana in general. You see somebody, yes.
I'll let you make your point and then I'll come
make
in.
The point. Somebody, you see a V8, BMW, whatever. Then he scrolls the thing and throws a paper outside. It's an attitudinal thing. So I'm saying, for me, the attitudinal agenda should not start from the civil or public service.
Okay.
We should look at it as a country from a childhood, from the schools. You go to Japan, you go to all those things are taught right from the school so that you know that you won't do this. I was on a program about a week ago, and I was saying that if we wait till the people come to the public service, I think it's about too late. There you need more of a deliverance session. But to link that to you, I think one of the key things we can do, or which we do, is putting some systems in place to ensure that people change. You see, change management is a very difficult thing, but you must be committed. I think you must be a bit crazy.
Yeah.
Because look at history. No country, no institution has developed on benevolence. And that is what I see at times, the hypocrisy of this country.
Okay.
We want change, but I want it to be done on the level of benevolence. It's not done anywhere.
No.
You need to be hard. You need to be tough. You need to be crazy. The president stands there and he says, look, civil servant, public servants, on the May Day, I think two years ago, our timelines not good and all that. And people start bashing left and right. It's not politics. Mm. It is true. Let me take away our traditional. I know I'm going to grant to drink water.
Okay.
We have our festivals. Mm. We say we're starting the program at 10. Mm-hmm. You get there at 10. Our traditional, we all dignity. They come at 11. Mm. You have 500 people seated waiting for 2 hours. Now you multiply two hours by 500. Now you're talking of 1,000 hours wasted waiting for people for them to come. That's a wrong attitude.
Okay.
That is a wrong attitude. Mm. Because we don't calculate, that having 500 people to wait
for just one.
For 2 hours, I'm also 1,000 hours gone. Mm. And you know how much money we can make out of that as a country.
Yeah.
So I'm saying the attitude thing, yes, it is there, but it's not just an issue of the civil service.
But it's heavy in the civil service, because there are some people who have moved from civil service to private sectors, and they've adhered to time, they've adjusted to the new structure, and they become more disciplined. They work effectively. But the moment they go back, then it's a different story altogether, because on Thursdays and Fridays is funeral weekend, so we are not working. It's free weekend for us and stuff like that.
Again, there's a lot of generalizing. Let me make this point. This whole concept starts from our pre-independence, the Abindia concept.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that, and I'm saying, well, that's why we are doing a lot of change. Let me give you a typical.
Okay.
Blunt. When I became head of civil service, my first meeting with my chief directors, we were supposed to have a breakfast meeting so that by 9:30 everybody would go to his office.
Yeah.
Well, there, I was there as usual. By 8:30, I had two people. By 9, I had only four out of the estimated 35.
Okay.
I was really mad.
Why?
Very mad. Mm. And everybody, we said what we were supposed to say. We went back to the office, issued a query to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
My next meeting, which was supposed to be the same 8, by 7:45, I had 95% present.
Hmm.
What is the thing? It means that we can make a change. Mm. We can put the system in place. We can provide the necessary leadership. So I agree with you that. And it's changing.
Yeah.
It is changing. We have moved a lot, but it's not. We are not there. And so I believe the civil service must continue, and we will continue. And hopefully, once the civil service gets us right, the other public services invariably follow.
Mm.
Let me go back a bit. Way back, 1993-94, this idea of service delivery charters, even client services unit, they did not start with the other public services. Even those that even private sector did not have, all those business started with the civil service.
All right.
I was head of reforms at that time. We got this thing going. And now everybody has a service charter, everybody has client service. So I believe sincerely that when we get the civil service properly positioned to support government agenda, the other public services learn, and then it affects the whole system.
So how do we change this then? I mean, talking about the attitude, how do we make changes to ensure that, you know, a lot of us become a bit more disciplined?
I think I've alluded to some of the leadership.
Of them, yeah.
We have, let's say currently we are moving gradually, encouraging all the ministries and departments to adopt the biometric system for coming, so that you come in at a point and
you log in.
So that is one way.
Mm-hmm.
From the office of the head of service, one of the deliverables or the performance agreements now is that you on a monthly basis produce a report showing how many people were on time, how many were late, what actions have been taken.
Okay.
And so that is something that is done, and there's a directory in my office that monitors this thing religiously.
Okay.
And so at the end of every month they do a summary and they give it to us.
Okay.
So where it's becoming repetitive, the chief director is called and you say, look, this is happening in your ministry, you can't have it. So I'm saying the systems must be in place, then we must continue with enforcement.
Okay.
It's not a miracle that is going to be.
Yeah.
But it's a principle that will follow, and over a period of time, I think we will get there.
What are some of the other reforms that you are, you know, asking for in the civil service?
It's not asking for. We
okay,
are working
we are
together.
Working towards it. Okay.
One of our key things that we talk of time consciousness is a major thing. We're talking of a right attitude to certain things.
Yeah.
One of the key things that we do is being responsive to their clients.
Okay.
You know, I have a fundamental problem where somebody comes to the office and if you are available, you say
then
wait.
You can, yeah.
No, that is completely unacceptable. And whenever The chief directors now know that, heads of department consistently know mm-hmm. that, and we are working towards, it's not completely out there, but I'm saying we're doing that, we're improving. Even in my own office, it mm-hmm. used to be a problem, but to a larger extent, it's gone. There was an article recently done by somebody who came to office of the head of civil service. He came to the client service and he was told that the officer is looking for, it's not around, but we'll call you.
Yeah.
He said he doubted that they'll be called back. He got to the house, and then the evening he received, a call from the officer saying, I was told you came to look for me. What is it? Can I help you? And so he wrote an article, I think the Ghanaian Times also, saying that change has come to the civil servant. So I'm saying it's a process. This is not a civil servant. He himself said he doubted. He said he knew that it was one of those things. So I believe sincerely we are getting there.
It's not
an easy process, but
all right. we will get there. Please tell me about the Civil Service Week celebration and awards.
Okay, thank you. The Civil Service Week, we used to have it, actually. It used to be a regular thing. Then it got merged with what we call the public service celebration, which was happens on the 22nd, 23rd of every year. It was a declaration by the AU. So that got submerged. But I thought that together with the current council, and we have a very strong civil service council, which is the governing board, the consensus was, look, let's rebrand the civil service. Okay. We are doing all these things, but it is imperative that at least once a year we go out and let people know some of the things that we're doing. So that basically is part of our rebranding activity. But beyond that, it's also reinforcing and rewarding, recognizing those who have performed in the course of the year. Because you have the performance agreements for both directors and chief directors. And when you've performed, we think, instead of, currently we do a bit of an awards thing, but it's not really big time. We want to do it big so that people are even given incentivized.
All right.
It's not as if being given money, but the recognition is one of the things. So it's a major component of the civil service thing. But we also want to go out. One of the things in the program is that we will go to Tema State. There's an open day for all ministries and departments where they open their doors and people just come in, ask questions, and we put together a panel made up of various service delivery so people can come and ask for how you can do services, and you'll be going to, I think, Makola, Tema Station Market, and stuff like that, to do some of this, in addition to the standard things of cleanup, blood donation or something.
When does this start? Is it a one-day celebration or is it a whole week?
No, it's a week. Monday coming is when we do a press lunch.
All right.
And hopefully TV3, who've always been a good partner, will come. Then we have a public lecture. Let me say the public lecture is very important because we have our team is improving service delivery to support Ghana Beyond.
All right.
We think that agenda, it's nothing to do with the politics of it. It's more of, look, everybody, it's good that we even become more independent. We use our own internal resources, our systems and structures deliver.
Yeah.
So we think the civil service should be pointing in that direction. So there's a big public lecture. We've invited the rector of Kempa, Professor Bonzi, to come and deliver. And then there are other colleagues, Dr. Sain, to also talk about this referendum, how it fits into it. Then the big day is a Friday, where His Excellency the Vice President has agreed to come to be part of. Of course, we'll not leave out God. So on Friday, there'll be Thanksgiving service and then the Muslim prayer. So that's what
looking forward to it, and a happy week in advance. Speaking to Nana Kwesi Ejekum Jamina. He's the head of civil service. It's been a pleasure speaking with you. Okay.